Tantor Audio presents Emergence, 7 Steps for Radical Life Change by Derek Rydall. Narrated by Derek Rydall. Foreword. From the ideological halls of academia, the frontiers of scientific research, and the hallowed walls of houses of worship echo the theories of philosophers, scientists, spiritual teachers, agnostics, atheists, pundits, and pathfinders. On a global level, you may also add to that list everyday people who are just as passionate about exploring the dynamics of human transformation, about diving into the depths of the evolutionary process and birthing their ultimate potential. Collectively, we ask the big questions about that which evolves the potentiality within galaxies and in you and me. The theory of emergence has a venerable history and has been debated at least since the time of Aristotle. In our 21st century, what is now called the Law of Emergence describes the architecture of the evolutionary process. Operative within the human being, it is the emergence of the ultimate state of consciousness that is our inborn birthright, which some call enlightenment, satori, moksha, or illumination. Imagine the planetary smile that would illuminate the spheres if the global family collectively came into harmony with the law of emergence. In truth, this is what has been happening since the Big Bang, which evolved from stardust to us. For as Carl Sagan wrote, we are all made of star stuff. So how does emergence emerge? As organically as the oak tree emerges from the acorn seed when the conditions are right. While we do not cause the law of emergence to emerge in our lives, we do create the conditions by which it can. When consciousness is sufficiently fertile, the lotus flower of enlightened awareness blooms within us. This fertilization process is the spiritual technology Derek Rydall teaches in his 7 stages for creating the right conditions for our emergibility to be activated. When, for example, you practice what Rydall calls cultivating congruent conditions, a new way of relating and responding to inner and outer circumstances that occur on any given day appears on our mental, emotional, and spiritual menu. Instead of launching a volley of mental or verbal napalm on others or ourselves, compassionate patience and forgiveness become new options. He also shows us how to put an end to outer spiritual pretense and make our practices applicable at the kitchen sink, driving on the freeway, walking our dog, or brushing our teeth, as it is on the meditation cushion or yoga mat. Without hesitation, he makes it abundantly clear that we don't have to swap the joys of being human for the attainment of enlightenment, and that we are already fine-tuned to serve the emergence of our inherently enlightened selves. In the laboratory of his own consciousness and through conducting test trials in his life, Rydall's 7 stages of emergeneering provided him with factual evidence of their practical and transformative results. You may be confident that whether you are a new or experienced practitioner, the book you are listening to is a trustworthy guide to the glorious potentials seeking to emerge in, through, and as your life. Michael Bernard Beckwith, Los Angeles, California. Preface: The End of Self-Improvement. What lies behind us and what lies before us are tiny matters compared to what lies within us. Ralph Waldo Emerson. They say the universe whispers in your ear, then taps you on the shoulder, and finally takes a 2x4 to your head. I had to almost die twice before I got the hint. I was broke, living in a 1-room apartment, eating 19-cent boxes of mac and cheese. I was heartbroken, the love of my life having left me for another man, and I was lost, with no idea where I was heading and no hope that things would ever change. But what made it all burn even more was that this was where I'd arrived after several years of serious self-help therapy. I'd worked hard to heal my past, love my inner child, and build my self-esteem. And yet I was so full of internal struggle and pain, I could hardly cross a bridge without having to fight the urge to drive off it. You know you found a dark place when the doctor says, "You're lucky to be alive," and you take that as bad news. I had nearly drunk myself to death the night before. Lying there in that emergency room, IV snaking out of my arm, the monitors telling me that I was indeed still among the living, all I could think about was, How did this happen? How did all my efforts get me here? After years of self-improvement, the only thing I'd improved was my ability to describe why I was so screwed up. I had tried everything I knew. I had followed all the so-called expert advice. Was the problem that I just hadn't found the right path yet? Or was it just me? Was I broken beyond repair? Now, most people who choose to heal or improve their life face this moment, this crisis point where they've done everything they're supposed to do and their life still isn't working. In these moments when we've been knocked down yet again and are seriously considering whether we even want to get back up, we tend to ask these basic questions. Why? Why me? Why, when I've done everything right, is everything so wrong? I know I ask those questions a lot until I was given an answer that not only changed the way I saw my life, but also made me see that I'd been asking the wrong questions all along. The answer came in two parts, separated by a couple years, like the cliffhanger of a television show leading to its shocking series finale. The storyline of my life, the character I'd been playing, and the play I was in, all of it finally made sense. The first part happened a short while after that night in the hospital, just when I started to stumble down what I thought was the right life path. I'd become good at playing the role of a guy with his life together, while inside I was still in pieces. But I was a struggling actor on the verge of a breakthrough, according to my agent, so there was no time to fall apart. I loved acting. It allowed me to explore new ideas and inhabit new possibilities, giving me a temporary respite from whatever real pain I was feeling. And I was good at it. I thought it was my true purpose. And finally, after years of paying my dues, I landed a movie role that I believe was the start of something good for me, something that would lead to the life I was meant for. I was right, but not at all in the way I'd imagined. The shoot was troubled from the start. While the Jamaican location was beautiful, the script was not. And when the director and lead actress were fired, things started to unravel. Add to that some messy on-location romances and a general lack of creative fulfillment, and I was feeling restless. I needed to find something, anything, to be inspired by. So during a break from shooting, I decided to do some late afternoon snorkeling in a patch reef far from the shore of a secluded bay. Swimming through the twining and twisting crests of elkhorn coral, sea fans, finger coral, I followed some strikingly colored fish playing amidst sponges and anemones. For a moment, I imagined being one of them, free from the burdens of life above. It was another world down there, almost mystical, and I wanted to lose myself in it. Be careful what you wish for, right? As I journeyed further into this labyrinth, giving no thought to where I was, I actually did get lost, really lost. I began frantically searching up and down the corridors of coral, trying to retrace my way, but the harder I tried, the more disoriented I became. How stupid could I be, I thought, my mind a storm of should-haves and if-onlys. I swam faster, my strokes angrier, as if somehow through sheer will I could break out of this underwater maze. Then, rounding a mass of coral that looked like a giant brain, something I seemed to be sorely lacking, I suddenly found myself stuck in a narrow pocket, fire coral surrounding me on all sides, the slightest contact of which would release the equivalent of hundreds of jellyfish stings, and rows of spiked coral below me, inches from my stomach, chest, and face. It looked like some booby-trapped tomb in an Indiana Jones movie. Only this was no movie set, and I was no longer a cocky actor playing the hero. I was in real trouble, and I knew it. I was barely able to use my hands to paddle and stay afloat. Lifting my head out of the water would have thrown my body off balance, skewering my neck and chest with the coral spikes. I could barely breathe in shallow, staccato gulps. A full breath would have pushed my chest and stomach straight into the spikes. The rapid breathing intensified my growing anxiety, creating a sort of euphoria that forced me to focus with every ounce of attention to keep from passing out. And with the little room I had left for thinking, I ran through every possible scenario for escape for what felt like hours, imagining everything from being rescued by a passing fishing boat to washing ashore blue-lipped, bloated, and bulgy-eyed, with a crowd of people standing around, shaking their heads and thinking, "What a shame." And the cast of my movie consoling each other as they grieve the tragic loss. I even managed to fantasize becoming a cover story in the Hollywood trades, mourning the untimely death of such a promising actor. Here I was on the verge of drowning, and my ego was still seeking its 15 minutes. But as the sun began to set and sand sharks began to weave through the twisting, spiked coral below, my body became exhausted, and my brain ran out of options as well as dramatic death scenes that would make me posthumously famous. I couldn't rationalize or fantasize my way out of this. All of my imagined wit and charm were useless. All my coping and defense mechanisms, even all my positive thinking, were impotent. The curtain was finally pulled back on my mind, and rather than being the master of the universe it proclaimed to be, it was exposed as nothing but a frightened little boy cowering at the controls, having no real power after all. I was going to drown, and I knew it. My body had nothing left to keep me afloat, and without any way out, I simply had no more hope to hold on to. All that remained was to surrender. Not one of those, "Dear God, if you get me out of this, I promise to go to church on Sunday" kind of surrenders. I had already tried to manipulate and negotiate my way out of this, and the universe wasn't bargaining. There was nothing left but to let go. So I did. And in that moment, in that exact moment that I gave up, mentally and physically, a wave lifted me onto the one safe coral area that protruded out of the water. I was finally able to stand, and for the first time I could see where I'd gotten stuck. The exit was inches from me all along. But I saw something else. Looking into that reef, I realized that I had been swimming through a maze for years, following one brightly colored thing after another, looking for something to fulfill me, until I found myself trapped in such a confined sense of self that I was gasping for air, drowning inside. But in that space of complete surrender, in that moment when my mind reached the end of the tape, in that gap between thoughts, something snapped. My ego was ripped from its moorings. Humpty Dumpty fell off the wall. And amidst the broken shell, something else emerged. It was only for a split second, but it was enough to dramatically change my identity. That self-centered actor who went into that reef was not the guy who swam out. But that was just the beginning of my swim through uncharted waters. For the next several months, I was tormented by dreams of destruction and an inexplicable fear of death. The truth is, I was dying. Not physically, but egoically. And the ego doesn't know the difference between the death of an identity and literal death. And in the space this death created, I caught a glimpse of a self that never dies. A self that needs no improvement. For this actor, endlessly trying to fill a bottomless pit of inadequacy, it was like being freed from a prison I hadn't even realized I was in. Again, it was only a glimpse, and I didn't have words to describe what I saw, but this time I got the message. I dropped out of acting, limited contact with my family, canceled my cable service, and for the next few years spent all my time meditating, sitting at the feet of spiritual masters, immersing myself in the wisdom teachings of the ages, and seeking a deeper relationship with this self that had swept me off my proverbial feet in my initial spiritual opening. I briefly studied to be a minister, and then explored becoming a monk. But while fasting in one monastery, I became so hungry that I broke into the monk's kitchen in the middle of the night and stole food. So that pretty much ended my monastic career. Ultimately, I became a licensed spiritual counselor at Agape International Spiritual Center, one of the country's largest trans-denominational spiritual communities, under the mentorship of Michael Bernard Beckwith. Armed with the metaphysical principles of manifestation, I began teaching artists, media professionals, and seekers around the world how to actualize their full potential. A thriving consulting practice and a couple of published books later, things seemed to be going well. I was getting results. My clients were getting results. This stuff really worked. Then I hit a wall. Everything became more of a struggle. Techniques I'd used before were no longer working well. When I did manifest what I thought I wanted, there wasn't as much satisfaction. And in some cases, the more I tried to improve things, the worse they got. Not just for me, but for countless others who were working with the latest success teachings. I persevered, but there was a rumbling beneath the surface. Something was wrong with this picture. Something was missing. I tried doubling my efforts, but that just got me more stuck, like pressing the gas pedal and the brakes at the same time. The tires were spinning, but I wasn't moving. I had this creeping feeling that I'd fallen back into that underwater maze again, but unsure of what I could do differently, I continued to teach. And shortly after that, during a talk I was giving, came breakthrough number two. It was at a spiritual center in a suburban strip mall, sandwiched between a dry cleaner and a tanning salon. The audience listened attentively as I paced before them, speaking passionately about achieving their potential. I'd spoken on this topic many times, and by all objective standards, I was on my game. But it was different that night. There was a tension in the air. The look on their faces wasn't one of inspiration, it was one of frustration. They'd heard it all before, tried it all before, and despite my enthusiastic delivery, they weren't buying it. I leaned forward, trying to verbally shake them out of their stupor, trying to infuse their hearts with the will to believe. But the harder I tried to inspire them, the more uninspired I was. I could feel the energy draining out of me as the words I spoke failed to ignite anything in them. Then something happened. I began to free fall, but instead of hitting the ground opened up like a painted backdrop. My perception of reality parted. There was a moment of surprise, then expansion. Then I saw it. In essence, I could see that the whole model of personal development was wrong. We don't need to attract anything because we aren't lacking anything. We don't need to improve ourselves because the self is already whole. Just as the oak is already in the acorn, everything we're meant to be and all we need to fulfill it is already in us, a perfect pattern and divine purpose. And like the oak from the acorn, when the conditions are right, this innate potential naturally emerges. This was the law of emergence. With this profound shift in perspective, it was clear that our deepest desires are not something we have to go out and get. They're clues to what's inside us trying to get out. Rather than struggling to heal ourselves, our work is to strip away our false exterior and reveal our innate wholeness. If we're already inherently complete, then all our efforts to fix, attract, or achieve something are, through the laws of deliberate creation, exacerbating our problems. This was why so many of our attempts to improve ourselves don't work or even make things worse. We attract a new partner, but have the same old fights. We manifest a bigger paycheck and end up broke at a higher income bracket. Like trying to dig ourselves out of a hole, the harder we dig, the deeper we get. When we start from the false premise that we're broken or inadequate, no matter what technique we use or how sincere our efforts, it can never lead to true fulfillment, but will keep us in a never-ending battle to improve a self that doesn't exist, except as a fictional concept in our head. These were the missing links I'd been searching for, the reason I and so many others had struggled to get lasting results, and the reason I'd nearly killed myself trying. As these insights burst into my awareness, I began to speak to my audience again. The truth is, there's nothing wrong with you. You're not missing anything. Everything you need to fulfill your destiny is within you, waiting to emerge. And most of your efforts to achieve it are actually blocking it from happening. This is not another self-improvement technique. In fact, this is the end of the self-improvement movement. I was shocked by what I had just said. I had declared an end to the very thing I was trying to be a leader in. I had called my own bluff. But what I could suddenly see so clearly, shimmering before me like a highway in the desert, was a radical new path for real transformation, a path that encompassed everything we need to fully realize our potential and inhabit our lives. It may have been the end of self-improvement, but it was the beginning of something so much more. Now, to be clear, I wasn't saying it was the end of personal development, the natural process of developing our innate talents and capacities. I was saying it was the end of the illusion that we are broken, inadequate beings that must fix or add something to ourselves to be complete. I was saying it was the end of this compulsive pursuit to fill a perceived hole that has no bottom or reach for a bar that is as elusive as the ever-receding horizon line. I was saying that the whole way we'd learned to actualize our potential was completely backward from how we were designed to grow. Worse than that, it was taking us further away from our true self, the very source of everything we were seeking. I quickly realized that if what I had discovered in the concept of emergence was true and was applied, there would soon be little need for self-help programs or gurus. Admittedly, this was not the most well-thought-out business strategy for an aspiring self-help guru. If my clients followed the law of emergence, I would eventually have no returning customers. Of course, that's actually the intention of sincere teachers. Their goal is never to create followers, but leaders, to give people back to themselves. From the framework of emergence, it's no longer about being a sage on the stage, but a guide on the side. And in that light, I realize there might still be a job for me after all. Just as it isn't the farmer's job to put the plant into the seed and make it grow, but simply to cultivate the conditions that allow the seed and soil to do what they're naturally designed for, so too is the role of a practitioner of emergence. I realized that this truth I had discovered acted as a law, like gravity. And like gravity, I didn't have to make it work. I just had to come into alignment with it and help others do the same. And the law would do the heavy lifting. That night, as I stood looking out at the audience, I knew the message of emergence was exactly what they needed to hear. And what followed confirmed it. The audience breathed a collective sigh, as if to say, free at last. And just like that, the tension in the room was gone. I closed my eyes and took a breath as well, letting it all sink in. When I looked back out at the audience, they weren't the same. Instead of seeing people who needed to improve themselves, what I saw were perfect beings waiting to emerge. I felt like Michelangelo, who believed that God had already created everything and his job was only to set free the completed masterpiece imprisoned in the block of stone. Staring into the faces of those audience members, what I saw were divine masterpieces hidden in blocks of mortal stone. And I knew that from that day forward, my work was not to fix or change anyone, but to help people set themselves free. With continuing economic stress, unemployment, and home loss, many of our external structures of security have been taken away. The wave of wealth creation books promising instant riches, ironically followed by the biggest economic crash since the Great Depression, has left many seekers feeling disillusioned. Now more than ever, people are looking for an authentic way to stabilize their life and reclaim their freedom. Emergence will lead you to that solid ground, in the only place the world can never touch, within you. At a time when so many are feeling fearful and uprooted, emergence will bring you home again, where you will find peace, inspiration, and the power to finally fulfill the purpose for which you were born. This book is the culmination of teaching the principle of emergence to tens of thousands of people around the world. My hope is that it will release you from the need to look outside for answers and authorities, from trying to fill up places you perceive to be empty, or even from trying to attract things. In this book, I will share with you the secret of your real sovereignty and power, the ancient truth that great mystics have tried to teach but has been largely lost, a principle that great leaders in every field have employed to create masterpieces, build empires, and ignite revolutionary forces, and yet has rarely been understood or articulated. Until now. Together, let's bid goodbye to self-improvement and begin the process of setting our real self free. Introduction: The Radical Path Home. We shall not cease from exploration, and at the end of all our exploring will be to arrive where we started and know the place for the first time. T.S. Eliot. My friend gives directions to her home via an oak tree. She says, "You'll come to a curve in the road, watch out for the rather large and unfortunate potholes. Next, you'll see a school crossing, and then right past that is a huge oak tree. That's where I'm at. Just park underneath and come on in. The door is open." Most of the world could give directions via oak trees. There are around 600 types, both evergreen and deciduous. And like many large families, they've traveled far and settled everywhere. They can be found in cool climes and tropical latitudes. In fact, they live on every continent but Antarctica. Unless you count the ships of old, made of oak, that sailed the treacherous seas to bring their treasures to that frozen landscape. The oak tree in front of my friend's home is well past 100 years in age, which means its taproot has forged very deep, almost as deep as the 30-foot height of the tree, with a trunk 7 feet around and a root system a third again the diameter of the tree's crown overhead. The deeply riveted bark has patches of smooth wood where it has been worn away by generations of weather and human hands touching the exposed heartwood as if feeling for a pulse of connection. This idea of connection seems apt, considering that oak trees used to be seen symbolically as a guardian of doors or the door itself, a door into the next season because it waxes and wanes as the seasons do, or the gateway between earth and heaven because it touches both the ground and the sky. It was a door of hospitality, a portal that looked simultaneously into the past, the present, and the future. Beyond a doorway, it has also stood as a keeper of knowledge and laws. The oak provided teachings for the people of the old cultures. It told them about the forest and offered examples of flexibility and generosity in its wood, both green and hard, leaves, tannin, acorns, galls, and bark. Those who held great wisdom were said to know the oak. It is no wonder, then, that humans have long sought to claim the attributes given to the oak in myth, culture, and history: strong, sustaining, reliable, majestic, and connected to the divine. The oak in front of my friend's home is venerable. That's a good word for a wise old oak, for it has seen much, its character traced in the nerves, in twists and turns of the trunk, and in its branches that reach out and up so exuberantly. In its life, this centenarian has lived in a way to be admired. From acorn to grandfather tree, it transformed in an amazing and, when you think about it, radical shift, from nut to green tree to mature, fully realized oak. It has lived each stage along the way wholly and holy, never resisting the emerging impulse that first cracked its protective shell and forced it to die to its acorn identity, never shying away from the soil as its roots were driven into the dark so that its branches could rise toward the light, never fearing the droughts but instead digging to find its deeper resources, never fighting the storms but standing strong when able, or bending instead of breaking, and never judging any stage as better or worse. The oak has things to teach us about emergence. The seed, the soil, the roots, the fruits. While I'll be enlisting the help of other metaphors throughout this book to explain the principles and practices of emergence, I've chosen to expand on the oak more than others. I could have picked many other trees. In one sense, the principles underlying all growth from seed to root to flower and fruit mirror the emergence process, but it's tough to beat the elegance of the oak. The great oak starts as an acorn, a small seed that we'd never expect to be able to bring forth such a mighty expression, capable of living for generations and providing food, shade, shelter, and so much more to hundreds of other creatures. Yet packed inside that seed is the invisible pattern, perfectly designed to become the oak. And not only one oak, but offspring that could become forests of oak, spanning eons. Inside that almost minuscule piece of carbon material is an infinite eternal potential. The same is true for you. Just as the acorn doesn't come here an empty shell and then set about making something of itself, neither were you designed for such a thing. The seed you started as already contained the material and mechanics of its fulfillment, and the fulfillment of everyone and everything that evolves from your life. Really think about the implications of that statement. Just as a single acorn contains endless forests, the seed of your being contains all the ideas, contributions, and impact your life will ever make, and the ripple effect your life has and will have on the world around you. All it takes is the right conditions for its emergence. As the acorn grows, the roots dig down into the dark soil, the detritus of all the things that have outlived their usefulness and fallen into decay. Working with nature rather than against it, using what exists rather than resisting it, the conditions are cultivated for its emergence. When we embrace all the dirt of our lives, tapping into the raw experiences we've been planted in, surrounded by, and sometimes nearly buried under, the process of emergence turns those dark, seemingly decayed parts into the nutrients that nourish new growth. We lose the struggle, judgment, and shame of a life spent trying to avoid, repress, or deny what is or has been, and transmute everything into something useful and supportive. We establish deep roots, bring forth rich fruits, and evolve the way nature intended. As the oak emerges, driving its roots deep and broad, its shoots rise up and out, reaching for the light. The deeper the roots go, the higher the branches can grow. The innate balance of nature understands that you can't have one without the other. If the tree strove for the light without grounding itself in the dark soil, it wouldn't be able to sustain its reach. A good drought would dry it out, a forest fire would burn it up, and a strong storm would topple it. Our human process of emergence is the same. When we ignore our roots and focus only on our reach, we lose our center of gravity and our source of sustenance. When we aren't grounded in a deeper place, in something that nourishes us beneath the surface of our busy lives, we become easily parched, burned out, and knocked down by the winds of change. But when we find our natural balance through the emergence process, we're able to reach higher and wider than our little acorn self had ever imagined, and often faster than expected. Just as the sapling has flushes, sudden growth spurts, sometimes several in a season, we too are capable of taking quantum leaps mentally, physically, spiritually, creatively, and in every other area of our life. The more rooted we are in the soil of our soul, the more connected we are with the seed of our true nature. And the more congruent we are between the two, the greater heights our life can scale. Finally, the oak matures, providing shade and shelter and seeding the world with new acorns that become new trees. As we emerge into our full potential and activate our deepest purpose, the gifts we share create and support an ecosystem that allows our world to evolve and thrive. This is the realization of the oak. It happens every time an acorn is allowed to emerge as nature had intended. When the conditions are right, nature always fulfills its promise. It can't do anything else. The acorn is whole, complete, and perfect in its acornness, in part because there's always an oak waiting under its cap, not a pine tree, not an apple tree, but an oak tree. Every time. We know this to be true. We know it would be foolish to believe that the acorn should become something else. We would never expect that an acorn, no matter how much pine tree training it went through, would ever become a Christmas tree. And we wouldn't want it to. Everything fulfills its function, which in turn supports everything else in an ever-expanding, self-sustaining system. This is also our realization as humans, if we are left to our natural course. Alas, we rarely have that luxury. The collective consciousness of separation, limitation, and self-preservation has created a false sense of self and a deep disconnect from the seed of our true nature. Rather than clearing away the debris that is gathered over the place we were planted and cultivating the soil of our soul, we have become lost in an attempt to become something other than what we truly are. Fortunately, the metaphor of the oak, of any naturally growing thing, holds true. As the acorn and its oak hood are perfect ideas that will always emerge when the conditions are right, so too will you. Please let that sink in. This is not just more New Age gobbledygook, a feel-good affirmation, or an interesting theory. This is universal truth. There really is an underlying order we can lean on, depend on, and trust. We see it every day in nature all around us. It's an order that doesn't require us to make it happen, but as Michael Bernard Beckwith says, to make it welcome. The process of emergence brings you back to this solid ground upon which your life can finally blossom into its full potential. Why emergence? Why now? With the availability of so many books and programs for improving our lives, fair questions would be, why emergence? Why now? I would follow it up with another question. How are the other options working out? Or to borrow a common question posed at the beginning of each U.S. presidential election cycle, are you better off than you were 4 years ago? And not just you, but everyone else. While we've made great strides as a society, we're still hungry, broke, scared, and killing each other at alarming rates. And if we aren't killing each other, we're killing ourselves. In the United States, there are twice as many suicides as homicides. And many more of us are just doing it slowly through food, drugs, stress, or repression of our true heart's desires. The hit television program The Walking Dead, it turns out, is a reality show. We've become zombies in a way, using all manner of quick fixes and distractions to numb us to the pain we're really feeling. Now, before you reach for that bottle of Pinot Grigio to wash away these troubling facts, please understand that I'm not a skeptic. In fact, I sometimes drive people up the wall with my idealistic and romantic musings. But I also know you can't heal what you don't feel, and you can't get where you want to go until you're honest with where you are. It's like those signs in a mall that read, "You are here." You need an accurate assessment of your starting point, or you'll just end up wandering in aimless circles. But there's something else that happens when we get conscious, I mean really conscious, about the state of things without judgment, blame, or shame. We start changing. If we're not living consciously, our ego will use every trick in its playbook to keep us the same, all the while making us think we're changing, convincing us we can't, or just dulling our senses with another episode of Here Comes Honey Boo Boo. The ego's job is self-preservation, often at any cost, and real change is a threat to its system software. It's an evolutionary artifact that was designed to ensure that this experiment called humanity made it. And with billions on the planet, it worked. Unfortunately, it's now the very thing decreasing our chances of survival. Let's face it, things aren't working the way we've been doing them. And no amount of doing more of the same, individually or collectively, will ever solve our problems. Please hear this. We will never solve our problems in any sustainable way doing things the way we've done them or being the people we've been. We must evolve. The only way to evolve is to go to a higher level. And the only way to go to a higher level is to access the evolutionary impulse beyond the conditioned mind and its endless tales of worry and woe. Because the conditioned mind can only create another version of its current condition. And how do you access and even accelerate this evolutionary impulse? Through the law of emergence and the process of emergineering. We've already covered why this is such a unique, even revolutionary path compared to what we've been taught. And this book is designed to give you a masterful ability to apply this revolutionary principle to every area of your life. But because the ego often resists any idea that could cause real change, asserting, "I already know this, there's nothing new here," or simply, "I don't get it." And because an acceptance of the basic premise of the law of emergence is necessary for its successful application, let me spend a few more moments explaining what's different about this. As stated before, the principle of emergence reveals that everything we could ever need is already within us, the exact opposite of how most of us have been conditioned to live. When we believe that someone or something outside us is our source of security or supply, we struggle and strive, fight and die, and generally twist ourselves into pretzels trying to get what we think we don't have or hold on to what we've already got. The result is endless anxiety, resentment, burnout, and way too many trips to the fridge in the middle of the night. Not to mention everything described earlier about our current state of affairs. This conflict ends when you live the principle of emergence in your life. And then the real fun begins. Imagine what your life could be like if you woke up every morning knowing and feeling that you held within you everything you could ever need. How would you interact with others? How much more open, generous, loving, and at peace would you be? If you knew that you held the design, mechanics, and power to create the life of your dreams within you, what new choices would you make? What bold actions might you take? Emergence is how you were designed to live. This is not an overstatement. It's what every great spiritual master or enlightened philosopher has expressed. It's how the whole universe is set up. It started with nothing and burst forth into everything. The Big Bang is the epitome of emergence. And you, being the universe in miniature, are a mini Big Bang waiting to happen. You are an individualized expression of infinite perfection, the offspring of the divine. You possess the same creative ability as the creative intelligence of the cosmos. Now, if you're still doubtful, maybe a little uncomfortable with all this talk of purpose and potential, unsure of how to let this inherent power and beauty emerge, you're not alone. This, after all, is the journey we're about to embark on, a journey that will take you home again, where your oak already stands, tall and majestic, the guardian of your soul and the doorway to your greatest life. Maybe you've been walking a particular path for a long time, searching for a sign that you were getting close. Maybe you've walked many paths, finding nothing but rocky terrain, washed out trails, and dead ends. Maybe you've stopped on the side of the road, feeling too weary to move on. Whatever twists and turns your travels have taken you on, the path has led you here, to this book, this moment, this map. A person who is true of heart and mind is said to have a heart of oak. That thing you feel, that thing that has driven you to find your way over mountains, through storms, and across rough waters, that is your oak heart calling you home. It's my greatest honor and privilege to join you on this liberating path back to yourself. Let's take a walk, shall we? What's inside? This book is broken into 9 chapters, starting with The Law of Emergence, which lays the spiritual, scientific, and philosophical foundation for re-engaging with this ancient principle. By doing so, we will clarify the critical difference between attraction and emergence, busting the myth of cause and effect, and turning the outside-in world inside out again, clearing the field of your mind and heart to be freshly cultivated for emergence. From there, you begin the 7 stages of emergeneering, 7 chapters that reframe the conventionally held concepts of self-actualization and manifestation within the new emergence model, and that guide you step by step through this revolutionary process of personal transformation. In stage 1, see the completed vision, you'll learn a unique excavation process for uncovering your true destiny, that seed of potential already planted in the soil of your soul. In stage 2, cultivate congruent conditions, you'll learn to bring your inner life into alignment with the vision, tuning the frequency of your mind like a radio to the station where your music is already playing, ending the struggle to make something happen and mastering the skill of making it welcome. In stage 3, create the quantum plan, you'll engineer the inner and outer vision into a way of life that takes you from living on accident to living on purpose. Stage 4, give what appears missing, reveals the real secret that whatever's missing is what we're not giving. We have an infinite storehouse of good locked up in our consciousness. In this chapter, you'll learn how to reverse the flow from getting something outside to letting this imprisoned potential out, freeing you from being dependent on anyone or anything. Stage 5, act as if you're it, once and for all clarifies the commonly misunderstood and misrepresented role of right action in channeling this untapped potential rather than achieving it, creating a streamlined effect that reduces inner resistance, cutting down the lag time, and accelerating the results. In stage 6, embrace what appears broken, you'll learn a powerful transformational process that gives you the tools to move through those critical thresholds of the mind that unconsciously sabotage your success and turn your flaws and fears into the fertilizer that grows deeper roots and richer fruits, activating the truly extraordinary in you. Stage 7, Wait on the Law, discusses one of the most distinctive features of emergence. The majority of the work is done below the surface, out of sight. Just as a farmer must nurture a seed and cultivate the soil until it firmly takes root, you must stay committed to what you've planted instead of jumping from seed to seed seeking short-term gain, or your seeds will never bear fruit. The practice of this principle develops what A Course in Miracles calls the infinite patience that produces immediate effects, and is the first step on the path to mastery. The journey culminates with Living on the Emerging Edge, where you are invited to become a visionary leader, an instrument for an idea bigger than you, that your life and contribution may help usher in the next stage of human evolution. How to work with this book. Books are great tools, but there's always the danger of becoming book smart without gaining true wisdom. The words can lift your consciousness to begin glimpsing your greater potential and seeing what's possible, but only by actively engaging the material and creating a daily practice will you experience real transformation and the gifts of greater aliveness, abundance, and fulfillment. This book is structured with each chapter building upon the previous one, so at first it might be best to listen to it from start to finish and grasp the overall concepts and principles. Once you have a handle on the basics, feel free to dive into any area that inspires you and do or redo the work. One suggestion, however, is to take your time. As you listen to each chapter, be aware of ideas or sentences that cause you to stop and think. That's a hint from your intuition that there's something more there, something between the lines, behind the words. Become still. Tune into that part of you that already has all the answers, and open up to the deeper wisdom that is trying to emerge. In this way, you may not finish the book as quickly as you're used to, But when you're done, you won't be the same person who began this journey. And finally, that is what this is, a journey, not a destination. When you realize that there really is no time or space, that everything is happening here and now, you see that there is no place to get to and no final goal to achieve. There is only the continuous discovery and expression of your infinite potential in this moment. That's the only raw material you have to work with. That's all you'll ever have to deal with, this moment. And as I hope you'll discover through this process, that's more than enough. Foundation, the Law of Emergence. More tears are shed over answered prayers than unanswered ones. Mother Teresa. Close your eyes for a moment and picture a one-month-old baby in a yellow onesie with rabbits embroidered on it. The baby is sleeping, perhaps cradled softly to someone's chest. Hold that image in your mind and notice what you're thinking about it. How do you feel toward this child? Are you thinking, she's so weak, so incapable, and really needs to lose a couple inches around the thighs? Or, his hair is thinning. He doesn't even have any teeth yet. All he does is eat and sleep. When is he going to make something of himself? He's such a burden. Sounds ridiculous, huh? Yet that's how we view ourselves as we grow up and become hypnotized by the cultural beliefs about what constitutes worth, value, and success. We begin to compare ourselves and others to everyone else until we have all but lost this awareness of our inherent innocence and perfection. But there's a place within you that has never stopped seeing yourself through the eyes of love, just as parents see their newborn children. This is the divine within, the presence that eternally holds you in its arms and knows the truth of your perfection. Reconnecting to this original truth is the foundation of emergence. Without this innate perfection as our starting premise, nothing we do will ever bring us the freedom and fulfillment we seek, but will put us on a never-ending treadmill, trying to fix, change, or improve what we think is wrong or lacking in order to finally be enough. Bonnie, a client of mine, understood this never-ending struggle. A little dynamo, Bonnie was always in motion, a do-gooder, a go-getter, and a caretaker all at once. Don't get me wrong, she's a great person. But a lot of her drive was motivated by the belief that she wasn't enough, and that if she could just be more or do more, she would finally become a successful version of herself. I just need to figure out how to get this business going, Bonnie said to me in one of our initial phone sessions. I'm about to lose my house, and if I do, I don't know where on earth my kids and I will go. I've tried so many things, I've spent so much money I didn't have. And my life still isn't working out. I don't know why I get myself in these messes. What am I missing that everyone else seems to understand? She was near tears as she spoke. I could hear the history in her voice. The subtext was thick, every word weighted down by a story of struggle. Before she finished her sentence, I knew where it was going. I've worked with many people in this situation, and the request is always some version of the same thing. Can you help me figure out how to bring more money in? But I'll let you in on a little secret. Money is rarely, if ever, the issue, even when it is. My life doesn't work was the real issue, which was a euphemism for I don't work. I'm broken. Something is wrong with me. And I'm afraid it's not fixable, that I'm not good enough or worthy enough to get what I really want and need. Bonnie is a strong woman with a gentle soul, who had been beaten down by circumstances. It's a place we can all recognize, a place we've all lived. Many of us still keep a change of clothes there. She just wanted to get out from under the pain, to get a little ahead of the game, to have some assurance that her children would be okay, and for the love of God, to finally be able to sleep through a single night. First, I'm really sorry you're going through this, I said. It sounds like you've been working really hard. You're obviously a good mother. She held her breath. Then her breathing became shallow, more labored. After thousands of hours listening to clients on the phone, I've developed an ability to read not only the story in their voice, but also the meaning in their breathing. Words are powerful clues, but the spaces between the words are often even more potent. It was obvious that she didn't think that highly of herself. But it was deeper than that. I could sense the guilt and shame she carried. She felt like a failure as a mother. Her whole life's struggle was depicted in those few moments of breathing, the staccato bursts of panic followed by the anxious attempt to catch a breath that seemed always to elude her. She had no idea just how deep her struggle was. She was lost in it. Now, as much as I've been trained to make space for people, my heart breaks a little every time I feel their suffering and I'm unable to fix it for them on the spot. I just want to end it. I wanted to reach through the phone and give her a well-deserved hug. I wanted to give her back to herself. But we can't do that for someone else. We must each reach for ourselves. Sometimes my work is to comfort the afflicted, but often it is to afflict the comfortable, to shake up the familiar, albeit limited, patterns. Bonnie wasn't going to like what I had to say. The problem is, no matter what you try, as long as you're coming from a place of fear and a feeling that you don't already have what you need, nothing you do will ever get you what you want. I let that sink in, expecting a mini rebellion. Instead, I got silence. I think she was waiting for the punchline. I continued. What's worse? All your efforts to improve things will just burn you out. Aren't you exhausted by all these attempts to make something happen in your life? Oh God, you have no idea. Believe me, I do. I nearly killed myself twice trying to improve myself.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.